Hello, and welcome to Retro Recipes. Hello. Well, on the menu today, on Retro Recipes, we're going to be exploring our fingers. Yeah, no, not those fingers. Although, fish and chips. Well, actually, today, funnily enough, we're going to be fixing chips. See, I think it's fair to say that on the Commodore 64, there can be many different faults. You'll know this if you saw my hammer repair video or the 3-hour live collaborative repair attempt video. But I think it's also fair to say that more often than not, the problem comes down to one thing. Actually, 8 things. Yeah, the RAM. Now, I do understand, and I see in the comments of my videos, that a lot of people who haven't tried soldering before are understandably wary of doing that. So today we're going to be showing you a way that you can both diagnose and fix perhaps the most common Commodore 64 fault using just your fingers. Welcome to Retro Recipes.
Welcome.
So here's the machine in question. This was given to us by David Philipe Gil. And you can see here the problem. Similar story with Jupiter Lander, which is a handy cartridge to use because it doesn't require the kernel and some other chips, so it can help narrow things down. If we consult the pictorial C64 fault guide, you can see the section with by far the most faults is the RAM section. And this looks pretty similar. So let's verify this using the Commodore Diagnostics and Utilities cartridge thing. Oh, now this is interesting. It's giving one flash and then waiting and repeating that one flash. So let's check the diagnostics manual. It says here, if a RAM error ID detected, the screen will begin flashing. That seems like what's happening. One flash means chip U12. So far we haven't used any tools. Now, you'll excuse the use of a screwdriver here. I do want to show you though how you can diagnose and fix this using just your fingers. So here is U12. Oh, sorry, that's the Lego version. Here is U12. But while I remember, please, if you haven't voted for Lego to mass produce this Brix-D4, please do. So in the intro, I mentioned that we're going to be exploring just our fingers, or of course we could use the paws. So all I'm going to do is feel each chip. And oh, that one is noticeably hotter than the others, and that is U12. Now I'll just prove the point here using the thermometer. It's just a thermometer. And you can see there, that chip, U12, is indeed at least 5 degrees hotter than all the others. So we're going to need some new RAM chips.
Excuse me. Hi, sorry. Do you sell RAM chips?
There we go.
Sorry, what's that?
It's a ham chip.
Not ham chips, RAM chips. Do you sell RAM chips?
Oh, sorry, we're out of stock.
Oh, you're out of stock of RAM. Okay,
sorry.
Thanks anyway.
Yeah. Where's Ashley when you need her? Well, not to worry, because I found these at Asda. So what I'm going to do is piggyback this new chip on top of the faulty one. And piggybacking just means push it down using the spring tension of the new pins so that it makes contact with all the pins. Right down to the PCB. And the same on the other side, all making good contact there. And now if we turn it on, yes, the blue screen of life. And our dead test works, as does the SID chip. And we can leave this running for a number of counts. Now it's important to note that this piggybacking technique is generally only possible with RAM chips, But why is that, and why does it work? Well, you see, RAM chips are what's known as tri-state logic. This just means that the chip is capable of three states. It can either be pulling current from the bus, creating a zero, supplying current to the bus, creating a one, or in a high impedance state. High impedance, also known as high Z, basically means the chip is electrically sort of invisible to the rest of the circuit. The use of this is really essential in shared electronic buses, just like the one the 8 Commodore 64 RAM chips share. I can demonstrate this pretty simply with a multimeter and set it to continuity mode. The meter will beep whenever it detects a connected circuit or trace. And so you can see here how the 8 RAM chips are indeed all sitting in seats on the same bus. That's terrifying. And with RAM, if the chip is faulty, usually signified by it overheating like that, it falls into that third high impedance state, effectively just becoming invisible to the rest of the circuit. On screen, this causes that garbled data that we saw. A simplified explanation of why it feels hot to the touch is that the voltage sort of accumulates in the chip rather than passing through to the rest of the circuit. When you piggyback a working chip on top of that invisible faulty chip, you're really just connecting a chip to a motherboard that thought that there was no chip in there at all. So that's how you diagnose and fix the most common Commodore 64 fault using just your fingers and a screwdriver. Now, if you wanted and you weren't going to be carting this Commodore 64 to your mate's house every day, you could leave this as is, maybe secure it down there with some thermal tape. But because we have got the tools here, we're going to do it properly and desolder, socket, and reinstall this new chip in its place. And while we're doing that, I think we'll just beautify this board a little bit and recap it just for good measure. But first...
Well, we didn't have any luck with our ham chips or RAM chips, but I did find this. Now, this reminds me, I want to give a very special thanks and shout out to all of my patrons, especially Jonathan Howard, who didn't join the silver patron level, but even higher, he joined the rhodium level, which includes a special on-camera greeting and thank you. So at some point I'll have to film that. But thanks seriously to all my patrons. You really help support this small retro channel, and I couldn't do it without you. Or that. Maybe next time.
So we can definitely give this board a bit of a cleanup. Yeah, this RF shield is effectively useless. Put that on eBay. And we get out our anti-static brush. And then to remove the bottom RF shield, we'll use this. And we just lever off these tabs after sucking them dry with removing the solder. Calm down. And from time to time, we do need to empty the chamber, which is easily done. And we'll just clean up nicely where those tabs were. And then we can actually desolder that faulty chip. Firstly, we'll add some new solder to get all the flux flowing. We'll drop in our socket. I'm just going to hold it down here with some thermal tape. And then what I like to do is solder both opposing corners first, and that way it holds it in tightly while you solder all the other pins. And here's our new chip from Asda. I found it in the freezer section. And let's test our work. Yay! Yay! So we're going to recap the board now, but first we need to move the dog out of the way. And this recap kit is again from the excellent Retrolium. By the way, if you can't even get to this stage and your Commodore 64 PCB is just beyond repair, you could always design your own completely new one, like this one by the fantastically named Arjan Versloot. I'll put a link in the description, and you could send the designs off to PCB Way, because as we all know, PCB stands for Piggybacked Clone Board. Pardon me. Now, just to recap, we were just about to recap. Make sure we put our new ones in the correct way around. Polarity does matter. Looking good so far. That's weird. So the solder actually went through that hole and came out the other end like a metal worm. Ooh. And to save myself turning around the board constantly, I'm going to desolder all of the same type of capacitor now in one go. There's the old ones, and there's the new ones. Ladies and gentlemen, the world's first Commodore 64 guitar. Ba-dang. Now, removing this Vic shield to get to the capacitor under there is always tricky, but I'm going to try this soft plastic Lego brick removal tool. Hey, that worked really well. Got some thermal paste on my thumb there. We'll just clean off this old one. Glued itself shut. Just a little dab. Not that kind of dab, kids. There you go. That's the heat chip for the Vic sink. Or something. And then we'll just spray our alcohol face this and clean up all the flux from those new capacitors. Really nice. Hey, that's me. We'll do one final test, although I'm pretty sure I got them all in the right way around. And yes, time for a nice game of Jupiter Lander. And I will do one final test, that is of the keyboard in place. So it just remains for me and the Commodore 64 to say I hope you found this video about how piggybacking works illuminating. Thanks for watching. Please like and subscribe. Comment below, and cheerio.